I'd like to welcome you on behalf of Educational Innovations for joining us today. We're really excited about this webinar. The people at Backyard Brains have developed some of the most amazing kits we've seen lately, and we're very proud to feature them on our site. I want to point out that if there's something we really try to do it at Educational Innovations, it's find products like these, things that are cutting edge, phenomenon-based, and are really going to make your students sit up and say, wow, Backyard Brains definitely is in that category. I'll just make a few quick notes. If you have questions, please ask them in the chat window, and we're going to dedicate time toward the end of the webinar to answer your questions. We'll also have a random drawing for a human-to-human interface kit at the end, so please make sure you stay tuned with us till the end. And that's it. At this point, I'd like to introduce Will Wharton, who's been bringing Backyard Brains into classrooms around the country. Go ahead, Will.
And let's see. I'll switch it to video. There we go. Sorry, hi. My name is Will, and I'm a neuroscientist with Backyard Brains. And thank you for that introduction, Donna. Like she mentioned, we develop tools and resources that we really think will make you and your students both go, oh, wow, because the work that we do is really kind of cutting edge, but still very accessible for students from elementary school on up. And that's a big part of our focus. And I'm going to talk you through a number of things today, and we'll try to be very careful on the time, because I know you're all taking time out of your days to join us. So I'm going to introduce a little bit of our work at Backyard Brains and the reason for our work. And then following that, I'm going to show you a couple of live hands-on demonstrations of the different tools and experiments that we do to study the brain and the nervous system. And then finally, we're going to have some time for Q&A and a raffle, and we can wrap up any closing information at that point. So let me switch back to my screen share. And we're going to start with, so the work that we do at Backyard Brains, right? We are a neuroscience education company, and neuroscience is a really interesting and fascinating and complex field of study. I think everyone here knows a little bit about what neuroscience might be, but maybe they don't know specifically what a neuroscientist does. And that's a big part of our work at Backyard Brains, because we think that neuroscience is exceedingly important. 1 in 5 people, according to the World Health Organization, are going to suffer from a neurological disorder or disease in their lifetime. And without treatments or cures for these disorders or diseases, I think it's safe to say that this is a very pressing social and health problem that we face just as a country and as a world. And if we don't have more students pursuing neuroscience as a research field, we might have a long, long time before we see treatments or cures for these things. Furthermore, this is an opportunity for us to engage students in subjects such as like mental health and neurological illness education, so that students can first of all feel more empathy towards people who suffer from these diseases and conditions, and also better understand them. We think that putting that scientific spin on it really helps take it from something that might be like ostracizing for students, but rather something that's scientific and objective. So how do we start studying the neuroscience questions that we're interested in, right? So you might be familiar with biology and astronomy. If you wanted to study biology, you can get a very inexpensive microscope to study cells. If you want to study astronomy, you can go to a grocery store or Walmart or some sort of superstore, and for probably under $150, get yourself a small telescope, which would allow you to start studying how the stars travel across the night sky and constellations and learn all about the cosmos. So for neuroscience, however, there really isn't that option. So the work that we've done at Backyard Brains is worked to take what you might have already pictured a neuroscience lab to be, you know, large expensive tools, people in lab coats, PhDs, graduate students, doctorates, studying the brain with very expensive and powerful tools. Well, we've decided to take those ideas, those same concepts that the graduate students and professors work with, and scale it down so that it's more simple and accessible for younger students. So we create kits, which are basically the $100 to $200 versions of what are typically $10,000 or more research tools. It's really a big step towards democratizing neuroscience education and making it both conceptually and financially accessible and affordable. So a number of the tools I'm going to demonstrate for you today are the result of that work. These all focus on the human body and nervous system. And I'm just going to run through these. These are all available on the Teacher Source website. We have the Muscle Spiker Box, which we're going to start with. We have the Heart and Brain Spiker Box. We have, sorry, I can't go back. We have a claw and a neuroprosthetic, which we're going to demonstrate and you'll see. And then lastly, we have the kit, which we'll be raffling off today, the human to human interface. And I've got lots to share about this product in particular, but it might be one of the most phenomenal labs you ever share with your students in the classroom. So I'm going to move back to my video here and switch to my webcam so that you can see what we're doing hands-on. Perfect. So the first thing, I lied, I forgot to reorganize the slides. The first thing I'm going to start with is actually the kit, which we call the Heart and Brain Spiker Box. And as you can see, all of our different tools, they're very small, durable, and easy to use. You pretty much plug in and then you turn them on and they're working. But what I'm going to show you here on my screen, I have these electrodes connected to me, connected to the spiker box, connected to the computer. And starting with the heart is a really good place to start teaching about the nervous system, because a lot of students might already be familiar with what their heart rate looks like thanks to popular culture and media, right? They see the beep, beep, beep in the medical drama. So it's kind of a good way to introduce them to how electricity in their own nervous system works. So as I'm plugged in right here, we can now look on my screen at my heart rate. It's racing just a little bit because I'm presenting to hundreds of people, which is exciting, but it's also a little nerve-wracking, right? So this is a way that we can start to zoom in on how the nervous system works. And so I'll tell you really briefly, the software that we see on screen is a free software that we offer called Spike Recorder, and it's available on just about any classroom device that you might have. So whether it's a Mac, a PC, an Android, even Chromebooks have accessibility with our software, and it's totally free to download, and it's accessible with all of our different tools. So we can see now, I can also turn on the beep, because students do love the beep. And maybe my speaker's not working for the beep because of this. No beep. Sorry, normally we can get the beep going, but I might have set something up ahead of time. So I've lied, but I promise you it's there. But so this is just a way, right, that we can start to introduce students to how their nervous system is an electrical system. And so this is a way that we can study the heart rate with a very simple EKG, an electrocardiogram, and introduce students to the way that their brain controls the rest of their body and nervous system. So following this, we can move on to other devices. So I'm going to plug in now to a different kit, which we call the Muscle Spiker Box. And this is further evidence of the electricity hidden within our nervous system. And the software itself, as you see, is very easy to use. You kind of pinch and drag and zoom if it's a touchscreen. Otherwise, it's very easy to use with a computer cursor or mouse also. But now, I'm going to plug in here to my muscles. And instead of recording from my heart, now we're going to record from another important electrical system in the nervous system, our muscles. So I turn this on, and I give it some revs and contractions here. We can see, and we can also hear. Sound coming from this. And usually when I'm in person doing these demonstrations to students or teachers, this is a great chance to ask some questions. Ask, what do you think this sound is? What do you think you're seeing on the screen? And different people have different answers. Some people say, well, it sounds kind of like static electricity or rain. Or you might be familiar with the William Gibson sci-fi novel Neuromancer, where the opening line is something, the sky was the color of a TV tuned to a dead station. And so we can almost say that this sound also sounds like a TV tuned to a dead station. But in reality, what we're listening to is the sound of our brain and of our nervous system. So as I flex, we can see and we can hear that kind of crunchy sound. So that's the electrical activity of my brain sending electrical signals through my nervous system telling my muscles to flex and contract. But we could do a quick experiment. If somebody else flexes my arm for me, yeah, nothing happens on the screen, right? That's because the signal has to come from my brain. It's not the mechanical motion, it's not the blood flow, it's not the muscles or tendons. It's actually the nervous system that we're recording. And so from here, I'm gonna introduce you quickly. We have free labs and experiments which are available online as PDFs and on our website, which allow you to start to record electrical signals from your nervous system and turn them into something quantifiable. So with the muscle spiker box, for example, we could have students start with maybe a sports science experiment where they're interested in how long they can flex their muscles and how long they can sustain that. Many of you might be familiar with the paperclip fatigue experiment, or just holding out a textbook at arm's length. So this is a way that we can actually turn that previously kind of subjective, imperfect science into something that is quantifiable for the classroom. So I'm going to show a couple other experiments here. I'm going to move on, and I can turn off this tablet here, because we're going to move on to a couple of the neural engineering kits. So neuroengineering for K-12 is quite the statement. So this is the claw. You know, Jim Carrey's the claw. It's the claw. We have Toy Story's the claw. It's going to grab. It's going to get you. So now I've plugged it into another kit, similar to the spiker boxes. But the claw bundle allows you to plug in and immediately take control of this neuroprosthetic using the electrical activity of your nervous system. So again, if Caitlin moves my hand for me, nothing happens because it's got to be my nervous system. So let's do a quick experiment. Can I pick up a pen and then sign my name on a check, endorse a check to all of you? Okay, you can't see, but this is exceedingly challenging. I got it, and I dropped it. So this is also a chance. We have a different way of programming this and getting students to think about neuroprosthetics and accessibility devices. Maybe a device that you have to sustain a muscle flex isn't the best for helping somebody with different abilities. So what if now that I flex, we've reprogrammed it to open when I flex. Now I should be able to pick up the pen, hopefully a little bit easier. And then as soon as I need to drop it, flex my muscles to drop. This is a really quick example of how we can start to challenge students to think about ideas, how they can both think about neuroprosthetics and accessibility and disability in new ways, and think of how we can see neuroscience and engineering as sciences that help people. So I call it the cool but why phenomena. When you show something to a student, they're like, that's cool, but why do I care? I think with a lot of these tools and these experiments, it's very obvious why they should care. And the answer is it's because it can help people and it can really impact members of their community. We've had students take this exact cloth in middle school and then come up with design projects around senior citizens that they've interviewed who have different ability differences, and then they've come up with ideas like how you can floss your teeth by flexing muscles in your shoulder, play a guitar string with a neuroprosthetic like this. So we can also turn this into an experiment that's very DIY, DIY neuroprosthetic in fact, and have students build their very own neuroprosthetic. So they can start with our pre-built claw, but then they can add on the DIY neuroprosthetic pack, which they can use to build their very own cyborg hands. And I think it's no exaggeration to say we may be the only people in the country creating and developing DIY neuroprosthetics for students as young as first and second grade. So as I flex now, you'll see we're plugged in to a very simple but very real neuroprosthetic. And so depending on the student's age, whether it's, I've worked with students as young as K through three building these hands, if they're hot glue gun ready, they're ready to build a neuroprosthetic. They're able to start learning about how their nervous system is an electrical system, right? And how that electricity can be used to control devices. Maybe it's something as easy as clicking a computer mouse by flexing your muscles for somebody with limited finger mobility. But then we can come up with creative ideas like this and then start building from there. You can see it's a very complex design. The small pencil, the golf pencil, pulls the strings, opens and closes the hand. But it's also mimicking the real hand's anatomy. We have pulleys, we have tendons. So we can learn a little bit about how our nervous system and muscles work together. So I've got one more experiment here, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about how these different tools can work in the classroom. So I mentioned we have the human-to-human experiment, and this is a kit that has been featured in a TED Talk, which is wildly popular. I'll mention a little bit about that later. But so this might be one of the most exciting experiments in the classroom. So I have my colleague here to help me with it. It does require two people, and it is what we would consider a mind control experiment. So I'm going to plug Caitlin's arm into my nervous system, and it's this webcam here, so we can move this around and hopefully not knock it down. I wish you guys could see it. I have a webcam taped to a folding chair sitting on top of my desk so that you can all see what's going on. But I've now wired up my nervous system to Caitlin's nervous system in just the same way that I was controlling the neuroprosthetics previously. We're going to see if a human nervous system is just as simple as our prosthetic and cyborg claws made out of pens and papers and acrylic. So when I turn on my signal amplifier, we're going to see what happens when I send that electrical signal from my brain nervous system into Caitlin's arm, see if it can put me in control of another human's nervous system. So look away, you're not cheating, right? You're not just doing this for the camera. So when I flex, we're going to begin to see a response. And can I turn it up a little bit? Is that okay? All right, that's the thumbs up. So now as I flex, we are stimulating against Caitlin's free will, her nervous system, the electrical signals from my nervous system are being sent into Caitlin's ulnar nerve, causing this contraction against her free will. So again, so it's a little bit hard to see, but if I wiggle my own hand with my other hand, just like Caitlin was flexing my hand earlier, nothing's happening, but as soon as I flex, we have this response. So this is actually representative, not only of a really fun and fantastic demonstration to show your students, we use it as a phenomena anchor, right? But furthermore, it's really representative of real physical therapy technology. You can imagine if somebody had nerve damage in their calf or lower leg, you could record muscles in the quadricep as they take a step and then stimulate their calf muscles past that nerve damage to help them pick up their foot and, and complete a step or a stride. Got her. But so I'll set you free because I've still got some more content to cover here. And thank you. And I'm going to switch back to my slideshow now to cover a couple of other subjects. If I can remember the button, screen share, back here. Great. So these tools and the work that we do at Back Air Brains, we call the Neuro Revolution. Like I said, the purpose of our work is to make neuroscience accessible and hands-on for students of all ages. All the labs you just saw, I've done with students as young as kindergarten through third grade. And what's really unique and interesting about all these labs, I think, is that since neuroscience is such a new subject for many students, all students are kind of starting off conceptually at the same place. So the same tools that we use to teach kindergartners and first and second and third graders, we also use to teach seventh and eighth graders and high schoolers and even undergraduates and graduate students. Like I said, these are the low-cost versions of real research tools. These aren't just a K-12 gimmick. These are really powerful and meaningful tools that we've just scaled down to be accessible for all backgrounds. As a few examples of that, we have students such as our fifth grader here who performed a muscle fatigue lab, and her project was to compare muscle fatigue in the left versus the right hand to see which was stronger and which would fatigue out more rapidly. So this is just a great example of how a student could take one of the kind of pre-formed experiments on our website and start to change it and modify it to come up with their own unique labs and classroom activities. So what starts off as a demonstration in the classroom might turn into a personal project or might turn into a science fair project. And we've had students move all the way up from, you know, school-wide science fair projects to district, states, and nationals. And then on the right side here, this is a little bit less exciting to see just in a slideshow, but that's an example. So the same tools that our fifth grade student was using, we've also used for real publications. So on our Google Scholar page, you can see graduate level publications we've submitted and had reviewed and approved using these low-cost DIY tools. Further from there, we have middle and high school students taking our tools and hacking them. This student took the brain behind the claw kit and used it to record electrical activity from different subjects and use it as a device that can alert the user to the onset of an epileptic seizure. So using muscle contractions and using some creative programming and coding, this student was able to create a device which was literally used to help people as she developed it. So we think that's really cool. And, oh no, did I click away? Further from there, we've had, like I said, everything from elementary, middle, high school science fair winners. And then we've also had students work in summer research programs. This is an example out of Rockefeller University, where they took students from all around the city to perform a week of neuroscience experiments in labs and activities. This was hosted by graduate students, and they used our tools because the graduate students weren't allowed to take the high schoolers into their expensive research labs, but instead they were able to use our tools to provide a lot of those same experiments and experiences for the students. So I think I just missed a slide. Let me see if I can get that back. Our work has also been recognized by a number of people, including the Obama administration White House. We were dubbed Champions of Change as part of our work in neuroscience education, which was also related to the Obama White House's Brain Initiative. where federally it was recognized that neuroscience is an incredibly important subject, and it's important for the health of our nation and the growth and development of our students. More students studying neuroscience and thinking about STEM education from this lens is better for everyone, as it has lots of opportunities to help people. So our goal is that we have K through fifth graders starting with something very simple, they're already doing work that a lot of undergraduates haven't touched yet. So if that's what they start off with in K-5, can you even imagine what they'll be doing when they turn 18 and start applying for universities? So from there, we've also had a lot of run-ins with Hollywood. We like to say we get a little bit Hollywood sometimes. So we've been on shows like Bill Nye Saves the World on Netflix. They did the human-to-human interface. We were on another Netflix show called The White Rabbit Project. We're in the first episode. And then we were also in a Zachary Quinto show of American Horror Story and Star Trek fame called In Search Of, based on the old series starring Leonard Nimoy. But similarly, they were interested in these questions of, first of all, how do you make neuroscience more accessible, and what are the implications of this for education and for the future? Furthermore, from there, we've given a number of TED Talks, and the TED Talks might be one of the most important assets that we have, because these are what we've put a lot of effort and energy into developing to take these complex ideas in neuroscience and make them accessible for students and teachers. So these TED Talks can be used as kind of some heavy lifting in your own classroom. You can use the TED Talks to show and tell some of the things before you bring the devices out. I like to say that it helps, is a good teaching aid. It gives some authority into the classroom from an expert, and it also frames it in a really fun way. That human-to-human interface TED Talk we gave has over 20 million views, and all of our TED Talks combined have over 35 million views. So it's kind of staggering, and honestly, if it weren't for TED, who knows if it would even still be a company today. So from there, I'd be happy to check in with Donna and see if we're on time to do some Q&A before the raffle.
Yeah, hi. Yes, we have a few questions coming in, and I want to encourage anyone who's got questions about what they've seen to write them down for us in the chat. Robin has asked, are the sensors reusable or are they consumable?
It's a good question. Let me just switch to my front-facing camera so I can speak to the audience. Yeah, so the little electrode stickers that we use, that's a good question. These are the only consumable involved, and they're very inexpensive. It's like $30 for 100 of the stickers, and the stickers are reusable multiple times within a few days. So usually when I work with students, the stickers come on a plastic sheet like this. I'll hand them their set of 3 or 5 stickers and say, these are your stickers for the next couple class periods. Put it back on. Otherwise, you owe me 25 cents or something. I know you might not commodify this for your students, but just to impress the importance on it that they don't just, you know, get silly, stick them on their face or something. So, but yeah. Quick answer, they're affordable consumables, I would argue.
And Michael wanted to know, where else can the electrodes be placed?
Yeah, so that's also a good answer. The answer is pretty much just about anywhere you have muscles to record from. So a couple of the kits I mentioned, so like the heart and brain kit, I was recording across my wrists, but you could do that across the chest, like the classic Einhoven's triangle with the different muscle experiments. That's one of the most exciting prospects for a student, is if they start with recording from their forearm muscle. We just choose that because it's really easy to demonstrate. But then they could do anything from like the tiny motor muscles in between their fingers to really large muscles like their quadriceps or chest or back muscles. So it opens up a lot of opportunity for students to kind of come up with their own variables in the experiments. So we even have one of my favorite labs with the muscle recording. We do what we would call muscle recruitment during chewing, where students can place the electrodes on their jaw muscles and then chew different kinds of candies and then see which candies require the most energy from their jaw muscles to actually chew. So you can come up with ideas like, we have taffies, we have hard candies, we have marshmallows. What is gonna take the most energy to chew and swallow? And some of the answers might surprise students, where a hard candy might, you know, have one hard bite and then gets really soft, but a taffy is just large, long, powerful chews. And that can all be quantified and turned into like very simple math equations and models also, which is really exciting.
Okay, thanks, Will. April wanted to know, is everything put together for you or is there a lot of setup?
So the only thing that we sell that isn't put together for you is the hand. This comes in like a DIY kit. We sell them in packs of 5 at a time. And it comes with all the different materials that you need, but it's not assembled. Everything else comes pre-assembled. And on that point, again, it's worth mentioning, I wanted to clarify a couple quick things. So the different devices you saw are all individual kits. So we have the Heart and Brain Spiker Box, for example, which is one kit at $150. We have the Muscle Spiker Box, for example, which is one kit at around the same price. And so I would typically say that any individual kit is a fantastic tool to use as a demonstration device in the classroom. And furthermore, for breaking down into small groups, I would say I typically work with students in groups of 2 to 4, 3 to 5, depending on the classroom size. And I would say that slightly larger groups are pretty acceptable because in my experience, the experiments are so hands-on and novel that you don't run into the quarterbacking problem where one student can just plug in and do the entire thing themselves, because you're going to be collecting data from each student in your group. All the students are going to get involved and have a chance to be hands-on with it. So, and then the last thing I wanted to say, so the claw bundle, which you get the claw and the recording device, is kind of like the starter kit, and then the DIY hand prosthetic kit is what we would consider an add-on. It plugs into the same kit. It just plugs in instead of the claw. They have the same way to plug in. So this is a way to take that claw experiment and turn it into something more interactive and hands-on where the students get to build and keep their own cyborg hand.
That's very cool. I'm getting a lot of great questions now. Let me see if I can stick for the moment to the ones that have to do with the stickers that we need, the electrodes. Mm-hmm. How many of those stickers come with the devices? And Laura is saying that she's noticed that, for instance, on our site, we do tell you a price to purchase extra stickers, but how many actually come with the kits, the electrodes?
Yeah, so with the actual kits themselves, I think a dozen stickers come with it. And the goal for that is, like, once you have it out, you can plug and play, do several experiments. And then from there, you do need to add the additional electrode stickers. And there's a few other ways around that too. If you want to get a little bit more life out of these, you can add a little bit of water once they start to dry out, tape them down. We've had people get creative and make them last quite a while. So,
okay. And let's see, can the raw or processed data be uploaded to a PC for processing in MATLAB? That's from James Plessa.
Yeah, absolutely. So all of our recording devices are pretty much powerful data acquisition tools, to use some of the more terminology at that level. So we record everything out as a WAV file, and that allows you to then take it into MATLAB or Python and do post-processing on it. The software I showed you, Spike Recorder, actually has a lot of kind of powerful post-processing built into it. We can do a lot of analysis on the signal itself. We can look at millivoltage range we're recording from. We can sort, we call it spike sorting, where we look for the peaks of all the signals. So that way we can do lots of kind of pretty advanced stuff. I don't want to get too much into detail there, but if you're interested to learn more about that, I will share Spike Recorder documentation with us as well.
Well, there are a couple of questions that relate specifically to the data, and let's see, I just want to read a few more of those. There are questions about, will these kits work well with the small Chromebook and other brand laptops? Is there a way through the software to see multiple recordings side by side for comparative purposes?
Yeah, so to answer those two quick, I will say that Chromebook has the most limited accessibility of our software. And the reason for that is we can't connect over USB. We have to connect over the audio jack. So we're just using the audio jack, the 3.5 millimeter plug, for that raw data. So we can still do that analog signal processing and recording, but it is a little bit more limited. So on like fully fledged Windows or Mac or Android devices, we can see multiple recordings on the same screen, depending on the device. And from there, we can also do, I saw another question kind of similar to this pop up, if like the post-processing and the more complicated stuff can be bypassed entirely. And the answer to that is yes. What you saw, we could do some very simple and quick, like drag and drop, like look at the strength of a signal in one quick window. We can do some very simple quantitative analysis or just look at the shapes and measure it that way. So basically it can be as simple or as complex as you need it to be, is what we've designed it for. So that way, same thing, like I mentioned before, a kindergarten or fifth grade classroom in that range could use it for very simple intro experiments, but then we could be working with advanced high schoolers and undergraduates to take that data out and then do much more advanced processing too.
Okay, thanks, Will. We are at 4:30, but I do have more questions, and I'd like to read a couple more if you guys can all stick with us. Tiffany wanted to know, does the kit come with inquiry sheets to get students started? Brian had a similar question. Do you have sample lessons available on your website? And there was also a question from Patty about available lesson plans and whether they're aligned with NGSS standards. Yeah.
So yeah, just kind of speak generally about the ecosystem of teaching resources that we have. We like to say that we're pretty bad business people. We run an unsustainable business model where we sell the physical hardware, but we give everything else away for free. So all of those teacher resources are available. The Teacher Source website has PDFs. I have additional resources and information that can be shared. But so the goal is that any one of these kits, there's anywhere from like 2 to 5 experiments or lessons that take a student from learning the very basics of how to just plug it in and use it to starting their first couple experiments and doing their first couple quantitative experiments. And the goal behind that is we want students to feel empowered, and we want the teachers obviously also to feel empowered to start experimenting with these in kind of a like on rails way. But after they've done a few experiments, then they can start hacking and modifying those experiments, coming up with your own variables and changing it up from there. And okay. Then as far as alignment goes, just to hit on that point really quick, we are NGSS aligned. I'd say our strongest alignment is actually in middle school NGSS, but we have alignment all the way from, I'd say, 3rd grade through 12th grade.
Okay. Now, a couple of people wanted to know about, again, back to consumables, the do-it-yourself hand kit. Can some of that be reused?
Yeah, so I would say that the DIY hand kits, it was designed with the intent that the student would keep it and take it home, but the materials could be reused. So just like, as with anything with hot glue, pretty much just with your fingernails, you can pop off the hot glue beads and then reuse the parts. I would say the only part that would be hard to disassemble would be when you hot glue this tiny servo motor to the piece of wood, you might be breaking off pieces of wood when you do it. But I'd say that, yes, you could reuse it and rebuild it. The only part you might have to replace entirely is the perhaps the most expensive element, the grocery store thread. I think I got grocery store thread that's typically used to wind up bacon onto steaks or something, you know, cooking twine. But.
Okay. Bear with me, please. Oh, I love this question from Michael. Can this pick up brain waves like a mind wave headset?
Yeah, so actually the Heart and Brain Spiker Box is named the Heart and the Brain because it can record from the heart and also, of course, the brain. So some of the initial experiments that we can do with this, it just takes a little bit more setup, so I didn't have the time to scope it into this demonstration. We have a headband that you put on and put a little bit of the goopy gel on and then clip in, just like you kind of clip onto our stickers. And then a couple of the initial experiments are looking for a signal that we call alpha waves. And in our brain, right, there's all of these neurons firing electrical signals, lots of stuff is going on, but we can see these average shapes emerge. So if we are looking, for example, at the back of the head, the part of the brain that's responsible for processing vision, when you close your eyes, that part of the brain has a little bit less, you know, work to do, honestly. So we're gonna be able to see larger averages come through, and those are alpha waves. So that's a really cool experiment where we can show students we're gonna do a real brain recording. We're gonna record from the occipital lobe of your brain and close your eyes, and you're gonna see these beautiful long waves emerge in the signal out of what was previously just kind of staticky, spiky noise. So we can do brain recording experiments, and those are some of the more complicated experiments. I would say I do that with mostly students 7th and 8th grade on up, and usually it starts just more of a demonstration, because recording from the brain is a very big challenge, and that's kind of the holy grail of neuroscience, right, is understanding more about how the brain works.
Mm-hmm. Peter wanted to know if you could quickly describe some of the cockroach labs, which we haven't gotten into, but yeah, I'm curious about those cockroach labs myself.
Yeah, no, so that's a product that we have on the docket to be added to the Teacher Source website. And just to quickly describe it, so we do work at Back Hair Brains in human physiology, which is a lot of the tools I demonstrated to you. But we also do experiments where we can record from the living neurons of invertebrates like cockroaches and crickets and grasshoppers. And I don't want to spend too much time on that, but a lot more of that information can be seen in our TED Talks, which you'll have links to in the slide deck that we'll send out following the webinar.
Okay, thank you. I know that I might have missed a question. I don't see, I will look for other questions, but right now I think we've answered pretty much all of them. Stephanie says she's coming to your facility to get help on how to do this in April. So that's exciting. And she teaches anatomy to 12th graders. I think at this point, why don't we get ahead, go ahead with the drawing. And we have, if anyone wants to continue on with us, I will continue to read off any questions that, that pop up. I do want to say that we will be sending you out a deck. We'll send you out a video copy of the webinar and a deck with Will's information on it. You can reach him at will@backyardbrains.com, or you can certainly write to us at info@teachersource.com. You can also call us at 203-748-3224. I'd like to thank all of you for attending, and I am going to continue on because I see some more questions are popping up. So let me get awesome. That going.
And I'd say I've got about 5 more minutes that I can stick around and continue
okay.
to chat.
Thanks, Will.
Questions. Yeah, gladly. And also, if there's any questions that we don't get around to answer, I'll make sure that we get all of those questions answered, and I'll include a link to a document of the slide deck with that Q&A.
Let's see. So Peter wanted to know, could you use enable the future 3D printed prosthetic hands?
Yeah, so actually that's a really good example. So my original inspiration for developing this DIY hand as a product was seeing lots of students involved in programs like Enable and other kind of 3D printing prosthetics hand development programs. And honestly, if you know anything about 3D printing, you know that it is a little bit finicky. And as a business, I'll just tell you, it is not sustainable to 3D print things and sell 3D printed things. So what I would say though is pretty much any sort of prosthetic hand or articulating hands or designs you can find online, they could easily be modified to be controlled in a similar way as this very simple prosthetic. And I've worked with students as young as 8th grade in particular who have 3D printed their own hands and then plugged it into servo motors to control either individual fingers or the entire hand grasping at once. And I would say that the biggest challenge is it is very hard to create a hand that you can one-to-one map the fingers. So if I flex my pointer finger, it flexes the hand's pointer finger. That's actually a very advanced project just because of how we process all that information that's coming out of the hand. But what is very doable and very easy is creating a hand that maybe has a couple different functions, or maybe individual fingers are controlled by different muscles or muscle groups entirely. So just to kind of give some background on that. So long answer, that short answer, yes, could definitely be compatible with other 3D printed prosthetics.
And Will, there's one more question. I think this is a really important one. Which kits do you recommend for K-4 just to get us started?
Yeah, so I'd say the kits that I recommend for K-4 are mostly the muscle physiology experiments. And my reason for that is I think that the muscle physiology is the most phenomenal for the students, where they can plug in their muscles and they can see something happening, they can hear something happening. And at those levels, I start a little bit just from the big picture ideas, right? That our nervous system is made up of these cells which conduct electricity, right? So if I'm thinking something, that's electricity swirling around in my brain, so to speak. But when I'm telling my muscles to move, that's an electrical system from my brain through my nervous system activating those muscles. And then you can prove it to the students, just like I showed you all during our demonstration, where if I flex versus when somebody else flexes my hand for me, we see different things. And then further from there, I've done a number of like public outreach events where I've had K-5 students building these hands. And I think that, so the muscle spiker box, the claw kit, and this DIY prosthetics kit, I would say are like the best K-5 options for introducing some of these cool big ideas, having that opportunity for students to come up with different experiments. And honestly, like for early elementary, experiments that I'm stoked to see are students just comparing different muscles. Say, does this bigger muscle have a bigger signal and a bigger reading? And that's kind of a really good place to start for younger students. And then getting on to 5th grade on up, I would say that students who are doing these questions where maybe they're interested in how their muscles fatigue over time and doing some very simple math is also a really kind of a big win for me when I'm working with students.
Wonderful. Well, I want to thank you, Will, and thank everyone for attending today. We'd really love to hear your feedback on the webinar and if it was useful to you. And we're excited to be able to offer more of these in the future. So please stay with us in the future. And thanks for your time today. I'm going to, I just saw one more question pop up, Will. I don't know if you have time for that.
Okay.
Many of your kits, James says, many of your kits have hardware and software processing for specific types of signals. For those of us who don't know a priori what kind of signals we need to focus on, might you ever consider a kit with adjustable processing?
Yeah, so it's kind of a tease to the future. Just to really quickly describe the reason why our kits are first of all so affordable and why we have these different kits to study different parts of the nervous system is what you're asking for is very similar to the real professional tools where you can adjust filters to look for different signals. So just for people who might not know the background of this, all these different signals we just recorded are happening basically at different speeds. So you can imagine like a brain signal is a very slow moving wave, but muscles contracting are very fast and sharp and spiky activities. So the way we identify those different signals is by basically setting filters which are looking for signals within a different speed. And so what James is asking about is a device which we can set our own filters on to identify signals in a specific range. And the answer is yes, we're working on developing one of those. It's not a product that's available yet. Just to give you an idea of the scope of that, it's something that we've been working on with a number of graduate institutions and the Marine Biological Lab and out of Woods Hole, Massachusetts, because we would like to offer that as a competitive tool for advanced high school and undergraduate students, but it's not something that is available right now, but it is in the works.
Well, that's a great teaser.
Good background on it. I know that gets a little bit insider baseball, but I hope I did a good job explaining it.
No, it's a good teaser. All right, I guess we are finished for today. Thank you so much. I'm really looking forward to your feedback. Thank you, Will. Everyone have a great day.
Cheers. Thanks, y'all.
Thanks. Bye-bye.